a voice alert contact on the way here.
I did.
There's one. I was very disappointed. 450 miles, and I made one contact, and it was about 50 miles away. So is there anybody in here that does not understand what voice alert is when we talk about APRS? Okay. Every APRS mobile operator is driving around out there with, if he's running a Kenwood or a radio that's got APRS built in, he's running packet on one side of the radio and voice on the other. And until we came up with voice alert, he's got the volume turned down on the packet side, and you're wasting a perfectly good radio. So voice alert says, turn the volume up, and instead of listening to the packets, set CTCSS 100. Now, you're an APRS operator, you're driving around, you're on everybody's map, and everybody on the planet knows that you're listening on 144.39 with a PL tone of 100. So it's you don't have to dial around to 5.2, you don't have to find out what frequency he's on. If he's mobile, he's running APRS, he's listening on 144.39 with PL 100, and you can give him a call. And so it's kind of like our own back channel, but it's always on and you're always listening. Now, there's another side benefit of that, and that is while you're driving along, if you get within simplex range, 3 or 4 miles of somebody else, all of a sudden you're going to hear, brap, you're going to hear his packet once a minute. And that's like a radar ping detector. It lets you know that somebody is within simplex range, and you're only going to hear one of those once a minute. It's worth listening to so that you can hear that somebody's in range. And it's a fantastic way to make contact while you're underway, because everybody on APRS in North America, he's listening on 143.439. And if he's running voice alert, he's also sending out a ping once a minute to let you know he's there. Great way to meet people simplex. Now, how many of you are kind of new to APRS, would like to hear just a couple of slides about what it's all about? Okay. In the past, I have not really done that. I'm going to do 5 slides. And the first one is a pretty old graphic, but it shows that APRS is basically a local network thing. 10, 15, 20 miles around the nearest digipeter. Of course, we can also put digipeters in space, and that's the drawing here. You got a satellite up there, but the satellites only come over for 10 minutes at a time. But basically, it's a local area network thing where you're situationally aware of everything going on in amateur radio around you because everything's beaconing on 144.39. However, in that footprint, or that local area, there's usually somebody hooked into the internet so that everything transmitted in that local area ends up going into the APRS IS or internet system and all over the world. So every packet transmitted by an APRS operator anywhere on the planet gets into the APRS internet system. And there you can have all kinds of applications such as email servers, findyou.com, APRS.fi, for accessing that information on the web. APRS is virtually everywhere. This is the 35-mile radius around Washington, D.C., Annapolis, and Baltimore, and you see there's over 300-some-odd users on the air at any one time. And across the country, well, the last time I counted, I haven't counted in 4 or 5 years, there were 20,000-plus people. And basically, it's a focus on the network is there. It's a focus on what are you going to do with amateur radio and how can APRS help you do that. And now we have both Yaesu and Kenwood that have APRS built into their radios. And of course, there's all kinds of public service events, races, marathons, things that people use APRS for. Tracking assets. I like to say that APRS is not a vehicle tracking system. APRS is a single channel, digital channel, which is the clearinghouse for anything that anybody is doing in amateur radio. They should put out a beacon there once every 10 minutes if they're not not moving. So that when you tune anywhere in the country, you arrive in your motel room, you turn on your radio, you monitor for 10 minutes, you should have then all the information of everything that's going on in amateur radio in that area. The locations of the repeaters, what the frequencies are, what the tones are, where everybody is, any nets that are in progress, any hamfests coming up, and so forth. So it's supposed to be just an information resource channel, not a vehicle tracking system. Now, we're starting to get into spring when people like to launch APRS balloons, so that's a good example of a remote data sensor. It's pretty neat that you can put together a little gizmo here the size of a grapefruit and put it anywhere on Earth, and you'll be able to get data back from that via the APRS IS to your desktop. Now, as you know, I work at the Naval Academy, and so I work with the students to build satellites, and so that's kind of my day job. So I will be talking here about some of the satellites. And so I have to justify to the Naval Academy why I want to build satellites, and here's an example of why we need APR satellites, and that is when you start doing a transatlantic balloon, as soon as you're offshore, you lose contact. And so, oh, I moved that. Oh, maybe I didn't save it. Anyway, here's another example of why we need APR satellites. This is a submarine that actually had four hams on board, or three hams. The skipper, the ops boss, and the chief engineer were all hams, and they're holding in their hands the Kenwood D7 radio, making a contact through one of the APRS satellites. And I like to quote the skipper when he surfaces with his submarine and he has no communications at all, 1200 baud is pretty good. Of course, last year or 2 years ago, we now have balloons that'll go around the world multiple times. And again, you don't know where they are until they come back and cross an APRS continent. And but if we had APRS satellites, then they could switch over to the satellite frequencies when they're over the ocean and be tracked. They're pretty tiny. You wonder how that thing went around the world four times, and you see it doesn't weigh very much. Now, of the APRS satellites that have been up there, PCSat on the left was our first one in 2001. It's the oldest surviving student satellite in space. And it's barely operational, but if you check its downlink webpage, there are packets coming from it every day, and a couple of people get through every day. PCSat-2, Andy and Raf have all deorbited. They were in low orbits. PSAT went up last May and is a perfectly viable satellite, but it's only transmitting at 300 milliwatts, so you kind of have to have a beam to receive it. So I'm going to talk about some of our other satellites. Again, the applications for an APR satellite are, offshore sailing, when you're out in the wilderness. I took the family on a trip out west, and every time I stopped seeing stations popping up on the on my mobile radio, I would just switch it over to the space frequency, 145.825, and just keep driving. And a couple times a day, as of now, three satellites, each one of them five times a day. That's 15 times a day. One of these satellites is going to come over, and you'll start hearing packets no matter where you are, out in the middle of nowhere, as long as you can see the sky. And when you see one of those packets, you know that you can transmit back up and get into it. And you also know that there'll be another pass exactly 90 minutes away. So these are our current crop of satellites. Or the ones in green are currently operational. The original PSAT in 2001. The ARIS, the Kenwood radio on the ISS, and then PSAT that I just mentioned. The two on the left, lower left, have deorbited. But QuickCom 1 is on ISS. It has been launched. It's delivered up there. And the FCC has said it cannot be turned on because it was built by students at the Naval Academy, and therefore it's not amateur. So we're fighting that battle, and any day now they're going to put it over in the trash to deorbit and burn up because we can't get the FCC to recognize what an amateur radio mission is. So we're building QuickCom 2, which I'll give a demo here. We're also building PSAT 2 and BRICSAT 2. As you know, there is activity all around the world. These are all the people that get in on a daily basis via the satellites. And so this is what's on PSAT 1, the one that's up there now. It has the Byonics 3.5 inch by 3.5 inch micro tracker. That's the comm system. And then it has an HF PSK uplink on 28 megahertz. and a downlink on UHF 435.350. And so you can just tune to 435.350 and just sit there all day long, and when PSAT comes over, you'll hear a carrier come up, and you'll have the waterfall just like PSK 31, and you'll see the users in there. And it's a full duplex system. That's what it looked like. The challenge was putting two UHF, two VHF, and one HF antennas all on that satellite. And I'm not sure if you can see them, but they're just little thin wires wrapped around it. And the science was figuring out how to get all those antennas to all end at one point. And that's where there's a little burn resistor there and with a piece of fishing line. And so when it's time to deploy the antennas, the resistor heats up and the line burns and it releases the antennas. Another unique thing about PSAT was that it spins all by itself just by the difference in sun pressure on the sides. You see that the black panels are offset to the left with a white strip down the right. That makes this thing spin at about 3 to 6 RPM. And so that keeps it evenly heated by the sun so nothing gets too hot. In order to make it spin around that vertical axis, you know, things like to spin around the flat axis. To make it spin around the vertical axis, we had to put all of the mass in the center of the spacecraft and leave the top and bottom pretty well empty. And as you see, it's pretty crammed in there. This is the third attempt at putting a PSK-31 transponder up there. It's working pretty well. The original one on PCSAT 2, we didn't get that much opportunity to turn it on, and the astronauts broke the antenna off when they installed it on the outside of the space station. But anyhow, now PSAT is operational. That's what the HF linear receiver looks like and the FM transmitter. Now, the interesting thing is, of course, PSK-31 has to be within 1 hertz in order to be decoded, and the DigiPan software can more or less accommodate about 1 hertz per second drift, but not anything more than that. And so that's why we have the uplink on 10 meters where there's very little Doppler, and then it all comes down on FM, so there's no Doppler added by the UHF downlink. And so you can pretty well track somebody as long as they're not on the edge of the footprint. But there has been a program written that will pre-shift your uplink. It's an uplink-only piece of PSK-31. So you run DigiPan to your sound card for receiving the PSK-31, and then you run this uplink-only software. And so you can run full duplex. So you're transmitting up on 10 meters and you're receiving down on UHF. Full duplex. Yeah, Andrew Flowers wrote this software. And now everybody you see in the waterfront, in the waterfall at the same time. And so you can just sit there and type as fast as you can, talking to everybody at once because they're all seeing you at the same time as well. This slide is how not to make a satellite. That's the flight board with all the little mods we made before we actually launched it. BricSat has electric propulsion on it. And again, that's another reason the FCC didn't like the idea. They says amateurs can't build propulsion systems. Well, you know, we've done it before, so why does this all of a sudden make it non-amateur? It uses just an arc, a little 1,000-volt arc, you know, just like a static arc when you touch a doorknob. And each one of those arcs blows away a little bit of the Teflon insulator, and it's that impact of that Teflon going off in space that gives you a little bit of a thrust in one direction. So we have a lot of, you know, magnetorquers and other things on there. The BricSat and PSAT deploy as a pair and then separate on orbit. And again, this is talking about some of the remote data applications. We've had some students work on this ice goat in the lower left. The idea was they just go up there, set it on the ice in the Arctic, and then leave it there. And then as the ice melts, it falls into the ocean, and then it follows the ice if the ice is moving, and then it falls into the ocean, and it follows the ocean currents around the Arctic. There's also Bureau of Ocean Management has a $1 million or something out there on the street that's asking for amateurs or anybody to design them a very low cost data network for getting such tracking information back from Wales. And I haven't bidden on that because I don't want to manage a project. I want to build little devices. So the slide on the left shows you that if you just transmit once every 2 minutes at 5 watts, you've got a good chance every day of being received by the network anywhere from 2 to 10 times. And so that's like for an ocean buoy project. So anyway, our whole concept in arguing to give us more money to build more satellites is that let us put up the satellites, and then you have all the students all around the world, including everybody in this room, that can think of ways to use those. We had a professor that was going to go to Outer Mongolia for his summer whatever, and we suggested that why didn't he take a little APRS weather station, stick it on a pole out there in the middle of Mongolia, and then when he comes back to his office, we can see what the weather's doing up there. So over the decades, we've made it smaller. So here's QuickCom 1. That's the one on the ISS that they will not let it be deployed because they don't agree that it has a license, even though we submitted all of our paperwork to the FCC. Snafu number two was it was going to have a beacon on the terrestrial frequency when it was over the U.S. and on the terrestrial frequency when it was over Europe. So now you didn't even have to track it. If you're out in the wilderness, you're away from the local network, you're still listening on 144.39. When this satellite came over, transmitting at 5 watts, which means it's a real strong signal, it would let you know that it's there. You would not uplink on that frequency because, of course, what it sees on 144.39 is totally saturated, but you would switch over to the space frequency and transmit up. But they're not letting us do that anymore. Because remember PCSat-1 that's been up there since 2001, it has kind of woken up and every now and then sends down a packet on a terrestrial frequency, and the Europeans don't like that. A little unique antenna deployment. You see the 20-inch antennas are just all spooled up in a little slot, and then there's just a resistor there with a nylon string wrapped around it. You put in about 3 watts into that resistor, and it releases the antenna. So now here's, this one is going to be turned on. And why didn't it show there? On August the 1st of this summer is when it's going to be launched. And what it does is it does what you guys have heard me for the last 16 years talk about, and has APRS touchstone, and that is you'll be able to not only use your Kenwood APRS radios for uplink, but you can also use any radio all the way back to an IC2AT if you want to that has a touchstone pad. And I'm going to try to demonstrate that. Let's see what the next slide is. Yes, so the first thing you do is while I'm stumbling up here, if you can turn your HTs to 145.825 so you can hear this demo because the radio is out there by the projector. So if you'll go to 145.825, or just a few of you. Every DTMF memory usually has 16 digits worth of memory. And so we've come up with a way to get your call sign down into 12 of those digits. And that leaves us 4 digits left over for communications. Well, 4 digits matches a grid square. So if I send a grid square, let's see if I do this right. Actually, let me show you what it's saying. So I'm going to send that again. Now, did you hear the packet come out? Okay, so not only does the DTMF go up, the voice comes down so that everybody that does not have a Kenwood or an APRS radio will hear the voice, but it also gets converted to packet. That comes down on the downlink, so it goes into the APRS network. Now, I'm going to send another message. Oh, so then we wanted people to be able to text message. And we started looking at all of the 15 years worth of text messaging that ham radio operators have said. And they usually say about three things, you know, here I am, do you see me? Can you hear me now? So we put all 99, so we had 99 messages. We put all the ARL radiograms and everything else we could think of already on the satellite. So all you got to do is pull out the number you want and have it speak it. So here I'm going to have it speak. Now notice that I selected message number 73, and then I have four digits to play with. So you can select any of the 99 messages, and then you have two digits worth of payload. So unfortunately, I programmed this to say 15 years. AMSAT's been in space for 40 some odd years now. But anyway, that's an example. Let me give you another example. Okay, but you know, ham radio is like, I like to make contact. Remember when I did the CQ or the grid square, it came back and says, grid square, you are contact number one. So now if I want to respond to that, let's see if I can do all this. First of all, here's another message. This one's not on there, see if you can hear it. So you can send a message, say, you know, call me back on such and such an HF frequency. I'm going to do one more. Okay, so remember, when I set up my grid square FM19, it says CQ number one. So now I'm going to send back a response to that. Okay, so you get to QSL that guy's number, and then it adds the number. So now all you got to do is QSL the numbers back and forth, and make your two-way contacts. That's QuickCom 2, which is manifest. It's tied to the payload. It's going to be launched in August. PSAT 2 now takes what we learned on QuickCom 2, and adds the PSK31 and the APRS transponder and the DTMF and the voice, and all that will be launched next March. It's the first one where we've spent the full $20,000 for a set of solar panels. And as you can see, in the center, we've taken the Tiny Track 4 from Byonics and put it onto a CubeSat standard card. We've added a 9600 baud UHF downlink. On the left is kind of the block diagram of the various boards. Down at the bottom is the PSK31, which, since you're going to be downloading this audio waterfall on UHF for the PSK31, why not put a slow scan TV camera on as well and let the slow scan TV camera use the center of the spectrum. Then there's the DTMF voice that I've just demonstrated. Then we have an attitude control system, and then we have the Byonics MicroTrack 4, which we're starting to call the SAT T4. But like I say, it's the first satellite that we're spending the full up amount for a full set of solar panels on the CubeSat, and that'll give us, instead of 1.5 watts, that'll give us 3 watts. So we went from $100 worth of solar panels to $20,000 to give us double the power. And the thing is, space people will do that. Here's the difference. The $2,000 worth of panels at my home will generate 3,000 watts of power. I can spend 10 times as much and get 1/1,000th as much power out of it and put it on a CubeSat. And the reason I put this slide up there is there's a lot of people that are saying, I'm waiting until they improve the technology of solar cells. Solar cells have been twice as efficient for the last 30 years. but the difference in price is 1,000 to 1, and it's just, you know, so the solar on our homes is as good as it gets, and it's cheaper than the utility, so why not go solar? And this is my last slide to just show that it's amazing that I can't believe I've lived long enough to not only get solar power at half the cost of utilities, but also you can now buy electric cars that are better, faster, and cheaper than the gas cars. And just last night, as I was preparing the slide, people say, well, we'll never get there. Portugal was at 100% renewable energy, powered their entire grid for 4 days in a row, ending yesterday. Hawaii reached 40% in 2014, Germany 60% in 2015, the Netherlands was the first one to reach 100% back in early 2016. So, you know, if you're not on the solar bandwagon and you got sun falling on your roof, you're really wasting energy. This is the last one. And the point is that since you can get free solar and now you can get an electric vehicle, combine the two together and you've got free transportation for the rest of your life. Six solar panels will fully charge a Prius every day for the rest of your life. 12 solar panels will fully charge a Chevrolet Volt, which is a daily 40-mile range, every day for the rest of your life. So that's what I've been kind of into the last couple of days, or last couple of years, is satellites and solar. And I wanted to share that with you. But now we've got a number of people to tell you some of the things, the exciting things that they're doing in APRS. And I think I'll start with Don Arnold. You're going to introduce what Kenwood has to talk about?
Sure. Can you switch the computer around? Hey, I'm Don W6GPS, and I want my Kenwood friends to come on up here real quick. I'm going to just do a quick introduction. I introduced one, and he will take care of the rest. So that's Josh Noda. He's the product planner at Kenwood, and I want to have.
This is Josh.
I'm sorry. Josh is going to introduce his friends here.
Oh, I'll do that too.
All right. Hey guys, yes, we're from Kenwood. My name is Kataro Sai. I'm local here at the Suwannee office down in Georgia. Same with Josh Noda-san. He's a product planning manager. And Kanji Kuroiwa-san. He hailed all the way from Japan. He's a software engineer. And we are excited to give you a little sneak peek of our new radio. We can't give much details out yet, but it will be released this year. So, yeah, please come visit our booth and learn some more.
Okay, and I'll bring up a picture here at the end.
Do you have a demo model at the booth?
Yes, we do. Yes, and we have little flyers here as well. I guess I'll leave them up front if you would like one. So,
limited amount. All right. Yep, let's activate that license, folks. Okay, so, little distractor. Anyway, y'all know me as the AVMap guy. AVMap has been in navigation for years. And then I kind of bumped into these guys actually about 12 years ago. And then I said, hey, can you create a GPS that can do APRS? And so they created a G4, didn't have a picture of that, G5 touchscreen. And then we've evolved to the G6, which, you know, some of you have seen my tactical mode and some of those unique things that the AVMap G6 has put together. And so it's made in Italy. It's a quality product. Been working hand-to-hand with Kenwood for about 10 years, developing software that would talk to their radio and talk to my GPS. So I'm just going to put a plug here. Any farmers? I got any farmers in here? I mean, I've got a big farm. Okay, so the AVMap, they've come up with this farm navigator, and it's a 7-inch screen. It's a big, heavy-duty thing. It'll auto-steer your tractor. It'll do spray control. It'll manage your field and all that stuff that I have nothing about. But I said, hey, do you think you could do something with that platform? So they said, yeah, we can see what we can do. So like last week, I got the firmware to make the G7 prototype to be APRS compatible. It's just basic right now. That antenna right there is a specialized antenna. It gets you down to, if it's really, really important, it'll get you down to 10 centimeters accuracy. It has 60 channels. It receives like three types of GPS. You guys can come to the Kenwood booth and see that. So anyway, the farm, back to the farm navigator, it manages your field, uses GPS, it's accurate to a couple inches, like I said, and it's a sprayer control. So I was all excited about this, except I wanted APRS. And so this more pictures of the field management. By the way, we are looking for somebody that knows a lot about farming and wants to get a product out there. We're looking for somebody that has some background in farming and farm equipment that we can get this to. So, in the Kenwood booth, I uploaded the firmware on my phone coming up Interstate 75 and did all my firmware update at 70 miles an hour to get it APRS activity on the, I guess we'll just call it a G7. So that's what the screenshot looks like. Haven't quite got all the features yet, but it's a really, really sharp, like 200 or 2440 by like 1400 resolution. I mean, it's basically a computer. I believe it's Linux based. And there's that big antenna that everybody's got to have one of those for that 2 or 3 inches accuracy. It's real important. So I asked this question here. I want to hear all my Kenwood APRS peoples. I want you to scream and yell loud. Let's, hey. Okay, now I want to hear all my D-Star users. Let's hear it. Yeah. Oh boy, you guys need some coffee. So now we're going to announce a radio with APRS and D-Star. And that's what we got in the booth. It's the Kenwood, I don't have a name for it. They don't have a name for it. We do have a flyer here with some information, and I'll basically, my quick talking points is, it's replacing the F6. It's a three band, 220, 2 meters, 440, built-in GPS, trans-reflector TFT display. It's a weatherproof toughness meeting IP54-55. Wideband and multi-mode reception for CW and HF, just like all the F6 features. And it's equipped with an IF filter for comfortable reception of SSB and CW. High performance DSP-based voice processor, and it's compliant with Bluetooth. Oh, that's interesting. Compliant with micro SD and micro USB. So we have a limited amount of flyers on the new Kenwood tri-band D-Star. Can I get a clap or something? Yeah, okay, thank you. And to answer everybody's question, it does not have DMR, so do not ask that question. So, anyway, yes, real quick.
9600. Yes, no?
They'll have to answer that question.
Price.
Cannot answer that question. I can tell you it's coming out this year. Can I tell them that? It's coming out this year. The name will also come out too. But what we wanted you guys to see this first. And so we want you to come to the Kenwood booth. The engineer is, they'll be here for the whole weekend. And that's all I have to say right now. All right?
It's pretty exciting.
The reason I was fumbling around up here before was somehow I didn't have the presentation loaded that I thought I had. And so slides were coming up that I didn't know that I had. So there's just one other thing that I wanted to mention along the lines of things that we do with APRS. And that is, as you've heard me talk about for the last 7 years now, I'm not sure, a couple of us go out up to the top of the mountains and try to do Appalachian Trail from Georgia to Maine. And after 6 years, we were finally successful end to end. And you know, we're trying to do it in 4 hours. We want everybody to be up there by noon, make the contacts, try to get that packet to go from one end to the other, and then come back, and then we can all go home, because we succeeded with the golden packet. And we have here in our audience, Tim. Stand up, Tim. Tim is the one that climbs Mount Katahdin. It's 1 mile straight up, 5,000 foot to the top. And he's what sets the time, because we've got to all be in place, because he has to start in the dark, climb the mountain with all of his gear. Hold up what you take up there. Remember, it's a 5,000. What is the base altitude? Oh, there you go. So he just takes an HT. That's all you need to be on the top of these mountains to relay. What's the base level?
Probably about 1,200 feet.
Yeah, so he's starting at 1,200 and going to 5,000 feet in just a few hours so that he can talk to us. And it's cold up there, and he dresses like that. You can hear him complaining up there of cold, wind, rain, and everything else. Anyway, after we've done this now for maybe this is the ninth year, I'm not sure, but we've been successful for the last three, we're going to do something different. After we established the 1200 baud contact, we just realized, hey, we got Kenwood radios, let's just switch to 9600 baud. Everything should still work, right? And once we've done that, we say, why in the world are we wasting 9600 baud just sending one packet back and forth? Let's make these sites permanent and establish an East Coast backbone 9600 baud just like we had, what, two decades ago with AX25 packet. We've got the radios. Kenwood's given us both 1200 and 9600 baud, but we're just so happy with 1200, we're just not using those radios. But everybody who has one of these radios, you got a 9600 baud packet capability. Why aren't we using those for the future of amateur radio? So anyway, that's what we're doing. Oh, and already four of those sites are permanent. The rest of them are just drive up. You drive up, park on the campground up there, not the campground, but park in the parking lot, do the event, and come back down. But four of them now we've already got permanent, and we're starting to find more. So if anybody has any sites along the Appalachian chain, we'd love to start putting up a permanent network. Okay, that's what I wanted to say. And now we got Byon from Byonics and MicroTrack. You got anything to plug in?
No. I'm going to be quick. I'm Byon N6BG. My company is Byonics. I'm over in the North Hall in booth number 223. And I do pretty much mostly APRS encoders, so the TinyTrack 3 and the TinyTrack 4 are mine, and also the MicroTrack line where we add radios to the TinyTrack. So if anybody has questions about APRS, we're happy to talk about it over in booth 223. And I brought two of our new products out just to give you a quick peek. This is our MTT4BT. It's basically our TinyTrack 4 with a built-in transceiver. And this year we've added a Bluetooth module to it. So rather than being wired to your computer, you can do Bluetooth into your APRS droid or your computer with Bluetooth or whatever. So it's a 8-watt frequency agile across 2-meter band, basically TinyTrack 4, the same thing that Bob's using in the satellites. The other thing that we've got that's new is our MicroTrack 1000. It's in this little orange case here. This is designed for high altitude ballooning. So it's got a high altitude GPS in it that'll work up to, I think it's 84 kilometers or something like that. 1 watt, actually more like 1.5, but that's more than overkill once you're in the air. Runs off of 3 AA batteries, and it's pretty much designed for high altitude ballooning. So we've also got some modifications for firmware for this to turn it into a fox hunting rig too, if people want to do that. So these are our two newest things that we've got. And like I said, I'd be happy to answer questions over at my booth if people have them about APRS. And that's about all I have, booth 223. Thanks.
I've lost my radio. Okay. There's one other thing I just remembered that I was going to try to show you. And that is, let's see if I can do this. Menu. Radio, where's the balance? Okay, remember how badly the speech synthesizer sounded on QuickCom 2, which is going up this this July? Well, we learned our lesson, and we're going to use a different speech synthesizer this time. So this is what will be on PSAT next March, and I'm going to go down and send the same message. Let me get on the right frequency for it. Okay.
Grid FM 19 from WB4APR CQ number 2.
Almost sounds like Steve Hawkins. Thank you. And let me do the next one.
WB4APR set message number 73 greetings from UMSAT, keeping ham radio in space for 15 years.
So anyway, we're learning as we go. And although I'm showing this in the space application, remember we've been playing with what I call APRS touchtone now since 2001. Byonics even makes a DTMF decoder. And I've written software to do an entire marathon where anybody on the marathon can report his position by just two digits, and then send his call sign from memory. And the two digits are the mile mark. You know, if you're at mile mark number 13 on the marathon, you just enter 13, memory, send, and now you show up on every APRS map as you're at mile mark number 13. By the same token, you can have the APRS touchtone thing reporting the lead runner. You can tell it always announce every time the lead runner comes in with a packet. So every time the lead runner transmits a packet, the APRS touchtone says lead runner at mile number 3.7 or whatever. Or the other thing we've done is lead runner is 3.5 miles northeast of the start. So in other words, don't think that when we're talking about voice with APRS that we're going to be reading off lat long numbers. No, you convert it into something that we humans understand, and that is a certain distance and direction from a known point. And so that's why you can do a marathon this way. For example, the way this would work is all the APRS operators are on 14439. All of the people with, you see it when you have an event in your club, 90% of the people show up with a walkie-talkie that can't do APRS. So APRS is kind of a sideshow, not the main thing. And so these other 20 people or 23 people are reporting all their information by voice on a very busy voice channel. Well, we're creating a third channel, which is a DTMF channel, and that is you enter your information by DTMF, and then you monitor that, and that's why on that voice frequency, you'll constantly hear every minute a voice announcement of where the lead runner is, for example, so that you can shut down the road or whatever your job there is. So I've always felt there's a very strong correlation between touchtone, voice, and APRS. And the reason is so that we could get everybody else that shows up an event to participate in the information flow without having to do it all by voice. As you know, we like to open the floor. I think we've got another 15 minutes. Oh, yes. UDR. Yeah, Brian Hoyer has his latest device.
Hi, I'm Brian, K7UDR with Northwest Digital Radio. And hi, Steve. And I was monitoring the APRS SIG group a while back, and Bob popped on and said, you know what I'm looking for? I'm looking for like an ironclad hardcore iGate for the Boy Scout Jamboree. And I thought the Boy Scout Jamboree was this year, but it's next year. So I said, that's fine. I'll deliver it to you at Dayton. So in my hand here is PiGate. So a project happened that we actually talked about at Dayton a year ago. How many folks know about the Yaesu DR1X repeater? Okay, about a third of you. So what it is, it's the new analog and Yaesu Fusion repeater for $500, now $600. It's an incredible buy. They've sold thousands of them, a couple thousand of them at least, and people were buying them for doing lots of stuff. Well, last year at Dayton, we looked at it and said, you know, we could do D-Star over that box. And so we put together a project to do D-Star over the Yaesu Fusion repeater. But then we looked at it and said, you know, you could also do 9600 packet over the Yaesu repeater. So what we've come up with is a Pi hat, which is now shipping. Looks like that. And what it basically is it's a complete one cable solution into the back of the DR1X. So 15 pin cable goes into the DR1X, goes into the Pi, Ethernet cable to do your iGate function. And now you can do D-Star or APRS iGate, and now you have PiGate. But there's more. There's a second connector over here, which is the standard Mini DIN 6 So you can put it into the back of any reasonable FM radio and do 1200 or 9600 baud APRS. So this is Bob's unit. We're going to donate two of these. One's going to go to you. One's going to go to Javier, because as you know, he's a big part of the APRS IS system, and he's going to be bringing it up on that. It'll be running Raspbian open source software with some stuff that we add to it, also open source to get all the drivers touched up, and then we're going to run APRX on it. We have a demo at our booth running Zaster, which it also runs, talking to a Yaesu FT817, and we're feeding it APRS from a Kenwood D710 at 9600. And that's decoding both on the Pi here and also on our UDRX. So we're at booth 515, EH515. And come on by and take a look at it. Any questions? Yes.
Comment. Are you familiar with Direwolf?
Yes.
Direwolf, as you may know, can decode APRS touch tone.
It's on here.
Yes. It's good stuff.
So we have Direwolf feeds APRX. And Direwolf by itself will do a lot of the beach stuff. And Direwolf has some new things that aren't on the version, which is on the repository, that are quite exciting to get even higher baud rates.
And it also works with an SDR dongle if you want receive only.
That's also correct. So if you wanted to build a bridge on your Pi, you could drop this on, go on a UHF rig at 9600, put an SDR dongle onto it, and listen. And then you could do something. I'm a great plagiarist. And one of the things I like, when I fly my plane, when you go into a tower, you have to listen to ATIS, the Automated Terminal Information System, which is a synopsis of what's going on. So think about this. If you have an SDR dongle collecting situational awareness on 2 meters, you can bolt it all together and then on an hourly basis, blurt out the synopsis, and then you don't have to wait for the 10 minutes to reacquire it all. So just an interesting piece of borrowed technology. Getting this on the Pi, open source, opens it up to an awful lot of people to play with D-Star and APRS and other technologies coming out. Any other thoughts, comments, questions? Thanks for your time.
Anybody else? John Hansen had said he might be here. Don't see him. Anybody else want to stand up and brag about your super duper APRS application that you used this last year? How many people know that they have active AX25 conventional packet in their area, whether they use it or not? So generally it's still out there. We've started all up and down the East Coast every night scanning a different frequency or just monitoring a different frequency to see what packets we pick up, because we go to the frequency coordinators and they say we don't coordinate packet. And so there's just no way to know what's out there without an infinite amount of Googling, and then you find things that aren't really on the air. But the only way to do it is just to really just start monitoring. And so if any of you live anywhere along those Appalachian states, please join us and start monitoring those old 145.01 all the way up to 145.77. And let's find out. We got to find one channel all up and down the East Coast that we can use for this 9600 baud backbone. Yes, sir?
On a related subject there, I'm finding there's not a lot of RF activity in terms of digipeding. It seems like everybody's collecting and putting it on the internet, but they're not digging it in the local area. So if you're out mobile and trying to pick up information that's not directly receivable simplex, nobody's digipeding it. So I just suggest if you got your ISS or whatever set up, enable the digipede function.
Yeah, I think what you're talking about is these receive-only iGates. Those really don't serve the amateur population that well, because the whole concept of the APRS messaging is two-way. And if we have people that have set up a one-way iGate, then everybody in the world sees that guy and they try to talk back to him and it doesn't come back out because it's a one-way iGate. Now, there are reasons why some people might put up a receive-only iGate, but they're really, they're almost as much of a disadvantage because they give the perception that you're getting in, that you have APRS communications, but you don't because nobody can talk back to you. Any other complaint or issue that people want to bring up? I brought up when I first started about not only not not that many people are monitoring voice alert, which again, instead of having the volume turned down, just turn the volume up on the 144.39 radio and set CTCSS 100, and it's all quiet. And if you do hear a packet, that's somebody in simplex range, and he's transmitting with a PL, so he's supposed to be listening, and so you can just call him. There was a hand up over here.
To address part of what he was saying, sometimes the digipeaters don't have internet capabilities to iGate stuff. So that might be where some of the iGates are coming from.
No, it's actually the opposite problem. I can get my packets out on the internet, but right. I can't see them or see other local packets locally because nobody's digipeding anymore.
Okay,
they're putting it on the internet. If I don't have internet access mobile, I can't see what's going on.
Well, and that's the same problem with people that are running apps on their APRS apps on their smartphone. They're going directly into the internet, and then all of us that are still on the radio don't see them, even though he's driving right next to you. So that is a concern. Let me say one more thing about voice alert, and that is please do not put voice alert on a digipeater or on your home station. There's nothing more frustrating than to be driving down the highway and you haven't heard anything on the APRS radio. I mean, you're seeing packets, of course. You know, you're seeing packets all 500 miles from Maryland to here. But all of a sudden, you hear a burp. That tells you there's somebody in simplex range that's on voice alert. And you call, and you call, and you call, and there's no answer. Why? Because he turned his volume down. Okay? If you're going to turn the volume down, then do not transmit PL100 because you're calling CQ and not listening. And it's even worse if you have a digipeater that's transmitting that PL, because now everything that goes through the digipeater is a burst that opens my squelch. And they totally kill voice alert then within a 100 square mile area, because everybody will turn it off. So again, make sure that only mobiles with a driver, a live human being that's listening, is transmitting voice alert. Yeah.
I went to a meeting down in Cincinnati a couple weeks ago, and they had a speaker talking about APRS, and we had a short discussion because he still believed that 1200 baud was the maximum you could run on 2 meters, like it was like 20 years ago.
Right.
I showed him, no, the FCC changed it, we can run 19K, but yet everybody's still running 1200 baud. I had somebody else say, well, 1200 baud isn't dead. And I said, yeah, you're the guys who made fun of me saying I was still on dial-up.
Right.
So, you know, why are we still running 1200 baud?
Well, one of the reasons is because the going to 9600 baud only gives you about a factor of 2 change because of the transmit delay. These are synthesized radios. There's a delay between the receive and the transmit. So when you add in the transmit delay of 100 milliseconds or so, the actual packet time at 9600 baud is so small that you end up with a packet that's only half as long. And by going to 9600 baud only to pick up a factor of 2, you leave out more than a factor of 2 people out there that are still running the old stuff. So that's why I realized it's been too long. We've got these 9600 baud radios. Let's start using them not for APRS, but for, backup emergency comm. If there's a backbone, see, when we have the backbone going down the Appalachian Mountains, you can be 100 miles on either side and get into that network. And so start promoting the emergency response packet capability. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
The voice alert, I did one contact. Is it in the comments section that you put the voice alert?
Oh, yes. And when you call somebody on voice alert, you know, when you switch over to 144.39 and you make a call, you must say CQ voice alert. You must use the word voice alert because this guy, he's been driving for 10 hours and he's been listening to the voice side of his radio, and all of a sudden somebody says CQ, and so he's going to pick up his microphone and he's going to talk back. He didn't realize you came in on the 144.39 PL100. So you've always got to use the word voice alert. So the guy says, oh, I got to go to band, the APRS band, and I say, okay, I'll meet you on 5.2, and now you go to 5.2. You want to get that voice off the channel as soon as you can, but it alerts you to the fact it's there.
I was listening to Simplex at the same time. So
yep.
I'm not sure what I heard. The voice, he said voice alert, he knew how to use that.
Right.
It was my first time, so I basically switched to that frequency and I saw it, but it's information that he put voice alert. That information, is it in the comment section that we need to program that?
Oh yes, in the D710, you status number 5 is the only one that will automatically insert your voice frequency. Now I'm not talking about voice alert. Now I'm talking about your status will always show what voice frequency you're on the B side of the radio. Okay, and that is status number 5. It'll automatically insert that. So that's where I put in. You know, there's the bracket that says frequency, and then I say and voice alert. So now what everybody sees as I'm driving down the highway, they see WB4APR, they see where I am, they see the frequency that my B side of the radio is listening to, and they also see that I'm listening on voice alert.
That was fixed in the 710GA.
Yeah, in the 710G, now you can put in voice alert on all of them. Now, there's one other thing, let me say about voice alert, and that is that Kenwood put voice alert in as a function several years ago, but the problem is if you use the menus to put on voice alert, you got to do the menu to turn it back off. So what we tell everybody to do, don't do it that way. Forget the voice alert function in the radio. Simply set up 3 channels in your radio, 144.39 with just standard 144.39. When you tune to that channel, you're going to hear the packets coming out of your radio because there's no squelch. Then 144.39 with CTCSS 100, and that's your normal channel. So now you're driving down the road with CTCSS 100 on channel number 1. But when all of a sudden you hear a packet or you want to hear what packet sounds like in this area, you don't have to go through the menus to turn off that CTCSS. You just go from channel 1 to channel 0, and now you're listening to 144.39 raw. There's usually a third channel we recommend, and that is 144.39 plus 600 offset, because you might want to use that in special events so that the digipeters at the special events are listening on 144.99, which is plus 600, and everybody at the event, though, is still on 144.39, you know, so that everybody sees everything on 144.39, but the people at the event are not competing with all those packets. Their input goes into the event digipeters on 99 and then come back out on 39. So we recommend at least those 3 APRS channels to be programmed, and that way you get voice alert just by choosing the channel that has the CTCSS set. Yes, sir.
A pet peeve of mine. And I know Byon, he lives a couple of cities away from me, built some really nice stuff. People buy a tiny track 3, put it in their car, and go, here I am driving a red car, and they put out the beacon. That is the equivalent of buying an FM transmitter, putting it on 146.34, and announcing every 30 minutes where you are driving around, but you can't talk to anyone on the repeater.
So again, there's no reason why these trackers can't include, you know, that's usually connected to an old radio that's a transmitter and receiver, and the guy's just transmitting. He's not doing anything on receive because it's a transmit-only tracker. There's no reason why he can't have that receiver turned up, volume up, with CTCS set. And so now, yeah, he's driving around in a tracker, but his tracker is saying, I'm listening on voice alert. So now you see him down the road, there's a fire up front, and you can now call him because you know what frequency he's on. And that's the thing that was always frustrating to me about APRS was one-way trackers. Why in the world do we have a ham radio guy out there who we cannot communicate with, and yet he's broadcasting his position? I don't care where he is if I can't talk to him. Any other pet peeves? There's one.
It's not a pet peeve. We noticed last year in New York State, and actually being interpreted into Ontario, that someone has actually parsed NOAA weather radio bulletins when a thunderstorm has been transmitted or something like that, taken that data and put it into a message status, one of the registers, and then APRS is carrying that bulletin out on APRS. Any idea how that's done?
There's all kinds of people that write applications, and when they tune in 144.39, they don't hear very much, and they say, well, you know, I want to see stuff. And so they say, what all can I throw on here? Well, you can throw it on APRS in your backyard, but don't digipede it out of your area. Nobody wants to hear your local, gee, isn't it great what I can do with this radio kind of stuff. Keep it in your own area, and that's your frequency to use. Put any information you want out there. And then if locals don't like it, they'll come over and cut your coax. But don't... That's the rule I've always had, is you can put anything on APRS as long as you keep it simplex direct, but just don't go out of your area.
So that would have to be localized into a local digipeater, say, controlled by yourself, and then not pumped in through the iGate to be pumped right up to other transmitters?
Generally, I say you can do one digipeater, because the digipeater is going to be in your area, and the guys will put it up, that everybody knows each other. But absolutely, do not do two hops of anything that is... that is this excessive stuff.
Thank you.
Any more? I think we've got one more minute.
Yeah.
I can't see the hand. Stand up. There you are. Okay.
On the same line about local data, what it's a problem in our area, and I don't know what we can do about people who will send out a repeater object, but they don't use an empty path. They'll use like two or three hops, and I'll be hearing repeaters that are 300 miles away.
Absolutely. What he's talking about is the frequency object. Every digipeater should include not only its own beacon showing itself on the map, it should also include a beacon showing what it recommends in that area of its footprint as the voice channel for travelers. And we call those frequency objects. And we want that originated by the digipeater itself, because the digipeater knows when the channel clears, and it can insert that packet in there for free and not add any load to the network. And it's only seen in the footprint of where that packet is. That packet is transmitted direct. What we don't want to see is those things transmitted one hop or two hops, because now they're going out of the area where anybody could possibly use that voice repeater. And even worse than that is somebody saying, well, I'm not going to go put these things into the repeater. I'm just going to put them on my computer, and I'm going to uplink these objects. Please don't do that, because when you uplink from the ground, you're hitting the digipeater when the channel is not known to be clear, and you're colliding with somebody else to put out this fixed thing that shows where the fire station is. You know, it's just crazy. You can send a packet that shows where the fire station is if that's important to you, but originate that at the digipeater, because the digipeater knows when the channel is clear and can insert that without cost. But don't put these objects in, first of all, more than one hop, and second of all, don't put them in from your computer, put them into the digipeater. And the other reason to put them in a digipeater is you only got three slots up there. So, you know, that'll limit you to decide what's the most important thing to put out. And like I say, these frequency objects are very important, because as I'm driving my 400 miles out here, all I had to do was look at the front screen of the Kenwood, see the frequency objects, see what repeaters were nearby, click on them, and hit the tune button, and the radio automatically tunes to the frequency, and away you go. Until then, you look at the position page, and you see that repeater is 500 miles away, that some guy was beacon being 10 hops, you know. So, the golden rule, you know, do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. Thank you very much for showing up at this year's Dayton, and we'll see you on the air. Brian, where's my DigiPie? Oh, there. You're going to have to give me some training on how to operate this. Isn't that amazing?